Well, good morning. It is very glad to see everybody here and to know that the big storm that we've all been dealing with over the past couple days has not eclipsed our press conference. I know, I told my staff not to do that, but we were going to go with the joke anyway. We are here today at the McAuliffe Shepherd Discovery Center, as it is very appropriate given that Monday is a very big day. It's a very big day across the country, but especially here in New Hampshire. Months of preparation have taken place, both on with everyone from DOT and fish and game, safety, travel and tourism, all the different pieces that go in to making Monday as successful as it can be, given that we are going to have a full totality of an eclipse to be observed right here in New Hampshire for the first time in a long, long time. For months now, state agencies have been working hand in hand with one another in close coordination with local communities and businesses, 14 state agencies, hundreds of people involved, volunteers, businesses, local communities, local public safety officials that have all really come together just to make sure that this one moment on Monday afternoon goes as smooth as possible. So while all of New Hampshire will experience the eclipse with 95% totality, the northernmost part of the state from Lancaster up to the Canadian border will be able to experience a full totality of the eclipse. Luckily, we all have friends like those here at the McAuliffe Shepherd Discovery Center who are going to share some more information on how to view the eclipse safely, and we really want to stress safety is a real issue here. It is. There have been issues in the past, we've heard, and we want to make sure that none of that gets repeated, whether folks have glasses or they're observing this once, what could be a once-in-a-lifetime event, whether it's for themselves, their kids, their schools, their communities, all these folks that are going to come out and experience it. Most importantly for all of us is safety. Now, we do expect thousands of visitors and families to travel to the Granite State for this opportunity. And for those who are planning to travel to New Hampshire, one thing we are telling everyone to pack is patience. Everybody, please be patient. There will be traffic, a lot of traffic going up north, and likely even a bigger traffic jam potentially coming back south as once the eclipse passes through New Hampshire. I kind of imagine it something like leaving a Patriots game or something. Everyone's going to be kind of leaving the North Country all at once. But if everyone's patient, everyone gives themselves enough time, understanding that it's a lot of folks coming out of a small area, we have no doubt that it can go off very, very successfully. For those traveling to New Hampshire this weekend, cleanup from yesterday's storm does still continue. Crews, we literally have thousands of crews right now out there restoring power. We still have about 100,000 people without power, but thousands of crews are out there today, and we expect to get, if not close to, but complete restoration, hopefully within the next 24 to 36 hours, which will give us at least a couple days ahead of schedule for the eclipse that will be coming to us on Monday afternoon. The weather does look very good, so we anticipate crowds to be high and interest to be very high. Not just here in New Hampshire, but coming out of places like Connecticut, Massachusetts, I anticipate that New Hampshire will be one of the top destinations for the entire New England region, given this once-in-a-lifetime event. We have a variety of folks here that are going to talk about different aspects of both how to view the eclipse safely, what we're doing in terms of transportation, what we're doing to make sure that folks have an opportunity to come up here and experience it. Just a quick reminder for those who are coming up, this is tax-free New Hampshire. I'd be remiss if I didn't put a plug in that it is a great opportunity for our businesses, whether you're coming or going, to experience a little bit of New Hampshire while you're, but you can sit in your car and wait in traffic, or you can, you know, visit a restaurant and visit one of our tax-free stores and enjoy all the economic opportunity that New Hampshire has to offer, again, in this once-in-a-lifetime event. I'm now going to turn it over to Jean Jurelskis, who's the executive director here at the McAuliffe Shepherd Discovery Center, to talk about how to actually view the eclipse.
Good morning, and thank you for being here. So this is a rare opportunity. You need to get outside and enjoy the view. The next solar eclipse in New Hampshire is going to be in 20,079, and I don't know about you, but I probably won't be here unless they figure out how to download my brain into a robot's body. So this is a chance to enjoy the moment with friends and family. The eclipse will be from 2:15 to 4:38 p.m. with the maximum coverage in our area will be 96% in Concord, and if you go up to Lancaster North, it's going to be 100%, and that'll be happening about 3:29 p.m. So be outside and enjoy it. But Do not look directly at the sun without protection. This is really important. The rays from the sun can burn your retina, leading to permanent vision loss. And this is even if there's only a little bit, the 4% that we have here in Concord, visible of the sun, it can still burn your retina without you ever feeling any pain. You'll just find out later. Sunglasses will not do the trick. You would need to have super good Ray-Bans and have about 8 pairs of them, and it's really hard to line them up just right, so that's a bad idea. Use eclipse glasses that you buy from legitimate dealers like the New Hampshire Science Museums and Centers or places listed on the eclipse page on the McCullough-Shepard Discovery Center's website, starhop.com, or the American Astronomical Society website, aas.org. And check when you get eclipse glasses that they have an ISO number on them that is 12312-2. ISO is International Standards Organization, and that will tell you that the glasses will protect you. So it's ISO 12312-2. If you happen to be a welder, amateur or professional, and you have a welder's helmet, a number 13 or 14 welder's helmet would also work. Be wary of buying any eclipse glasses through big dealers like Amazon or Temu, et cetera, where certification quality is not guaranteed. And only look through binoculars or telescopes that have solar filters, because otherwise you will really damage your eyes. There are other ways to view the eclipse for those not traveling north and for those who do not have access to eclipse glasses. You can visit the McCullough-Shepard Discovery Center in Concord from noon to 5 on Monday, April 8. We will have eclipse glasses for all of our visitors to use, and we'll have a variety of other activities, rain or shine, but it looks like it's going to be a beautiful day, so we're looking forward to being outside and having events inside. We'll be making pinhole cameras, looking through colanders, and you can check out our website again to find various ways of projecting the eclipse down onto the ground with your own spaghetti colander or your own cereal boxes that you can make into pinhole cameras. You could also join the Sea Science Center team. They'll be at the Arms Park in Manchester observing the eclipse. You can go to the NHTI campus where there are some students who are assisting eclipse viewers. And for those of you who have children in the Boys and Girls Club of Central New Hampshire, all the kids are going to be having safe viewing activities as well. We will have a light sound device from Harvard, thanks to Sea Science Center. They have one as well for visually impaired people. So that will be available to use at the Discovery Center in Arms Park. So remember, get outside, enjoy this. It really a wonderful experience, and keep your vision for the next time. Okay, thank you. And next up is Laurie Harnoy from, she's the Director of Travel and Tourism.
Hi, everyone. Well, I am super excited to be here today. I feel like I've been talking about the eclipse for the past 2.5 years. So it's so exciting that it's happening and that it's here. New Hampshire is very lucky. We're only one of 13 states in America that are going to see this total solar eclipse. And as you've heard, it's will be in the path of totality from Lancaster north. But as you can tell, all of New Hampshire will have a great opportunity to see the solar eclipse, even though that they may not be right in that total path of totality. The last time that New Hampshire was in the direct path of the solar eclipse was in 1959, and the next time won't be here until 2079. It's really, as Jeannie said, a once-in-a-lifetime experience for most of us, so very excited about that. The team at the Division of Travel and Tourism has been working with the tourism industry for the past 2.5 years to get them prepped and ready for this natural phenomenon. We've been supplying the lodging facilities throughout the state with the official solar eclipse glasses. I've got my prop here. I'd have them on, but I wouldn't be able to see my notes. So those have been supplied to the lodging facilities throughout the state to make sure that our visitors are prepared to see the solar eclipse. the number one question that we've been getting throughout this whole process is how many people are coming? And it's a really difficult question to answer. There's lots of variables that go into that, whether people are coming up. And what we encourage people to do is to come early, spend the weekend here in New Hampshire, experience a lot of the great activities that are open, but also the number of day travelers. We're still unknown of who's just doing a day trip up. And of course, the other variable is the weather, which is, I think we all did the dance and it looks like clear skies. So we're excited about that. What we have learned from the other states that participated in the total solar eclipse back in 2017, that there's a very significant economic impact that this natural event brings in. So we're expecting a great number of visitors. We know at this point that there's little to no lodging availability in the Great North Woods. So hopefully you planned ahead if you wanted to stay here stay overnight. But our conservative calculations show that that's approximately 10,000 additional overnight visitors that will come to the region. And that doesn't factor in the camps and family people that are coming to stay with family. So that's just the lodging facilities that are in that area. And of course, we hope that this will be a great opportunity, especially in the shoulder season of the state. We're typically what we call mud season. So this is a great opportunity to bring travelers here. They'll experience New Hampshire, and we really think that there'll be an economic benefit to come. So they'll see New Hampshire and hopefully book another vacation here in our great state of New Hampshire. I want to just say that for anybody that's looking for all things of where to go, viewing places to see, where they can park, go to nhsolareclipse.com. That's a one-stop resource that we have worked with the other state departments to communicate to visitors what where are the best places to go. And we're just very excited for this natural phenomenon, and hopefully everyone has a nice time here in New Hampshire. I ask to remind visitors to be respectful to and pack their patience, as the governor said, but be respectful to the residents here in New Hampshire and their properties, and park where it's where they should be parking. So at this time, I think I'd like to invite Tim Stevens to the stand and to talk about Colbert.
Good morning. Like she said, my name is Tim Stevens. I am the town manager for Colebrook. For those of you who don't know, we did have about a foot of snow dumped out there over the last day and a half. But even with that, we're still not canceling the eclipse. Still happening, right?
Still
it's still happening on Monday, so we're not canceling it. But that brings some interesting things for us up there and for those traveling. So I just want to talk about a couple things. Public safety, we've been working in depth with law enforcement, fire, EMS, the hospital, and ensuring that we've covered to the best of our ability all those issues. For the most part, it's going to be all hands on deck during the busy travel times, Sunday night into Monday night, Tuesday morning. We're going to have all hands on deck being ready to take care of all this. Additionally, we've set up a couple first aid stations. So in the town of Colebrook, we'll have two first aid stations set up. One will be at the high school, at the top entrance of the high school off of Main Street, Community Baptist Church, which is right beside the town hall on Bridge Street. And those are first aid stations to alleviate some of the minor issues from going up and overwhelming the hospital. As has been said, there could potentially be, in addition to those lodging, tens of thousands of people coming into the area, and that could possibly be the largest influx of personnel that they've ever seen in that part of the state. So we are trying to ensure that all the safety issues are covered. We also have CERT teams that are going to be there helping with some of the parking and traffic to assist in that area. One thing we want to remind everybody is things like private property. We have a lot of open fields besides the two main roads that we have going into Colebrook. We have Route 3 and we have Route 26. A lot of people have cornfields, a lot of people have hay fields, and those fields might be enticing for the eclipse chaser to want to get out in the middle of and watch the eclipse from. The problem is, as I said, we've got a foot of snow right now on top of our mud season. Those who get out there, you might be there for a little bit. We don't have a whole lot of tow trucks in the area. Our tow trucks have been directed that their main goal is going to be to keep the travel routes open. So those that go out in the middle of fields and get stuck, you'll be gotten to when you can be gotten to. And until then, we're going to make sure our roads can be traveled on and we don't have a parking lot on Route 3 and Route 26. So we got the private property, the fields. We've also got driveways. People do live up there. They do have driveways. Just because you see a driveway, please don't consider that invitation to park there. People might have to get in and out of their driveways. Those do belong to the homeowners. We also want to mention something to those of you who have gone out and done your research on Google Maps. There are a lot of real interesting and enticing places up there. We have Table Rock, the Balsams, we have Monadnock, we have McGalloway, all these areas that could be real interesting to get up to the top of and view, understanding that, again, we have a foot of snow on top of mud and ice, and those who travel off the beaten path to try to go to some of these areas might find themselves in an area that isn't real comfortable to be in, and they might be up to their waist in mud and snow, and that's a serious safety issue. And we do have our fish and game and state police are all prepared for any of those type of responses. We're just hoping to minimize it by getting the word out there that those areas might not be great areas to go up to. Another area of concern is we got a lot of lakes up there. Those lakes do have ice on them. However, they don't have ice that can hold people. So we don't want people going out onto the lakes up there. The ice is going to be thin. It's not going to be unheard of for someone to get out there and fall through some ice on one of our beautiful lakes. So please don't go out onto the lakes. Consider the fact that there's going to be some open water out there. The local businesses, we've had meetings with the local businesses in the chamber up there. We've had presentations for them, letting them know that this could be the busiest time that you've ever seen up here. So they've all done what they could as far as scheduling resupplies, ensuring that they're getting new stuff in, gas stations, restaurants, they're able to do that. We don't really have the infrastructure to handle this amount of people, so they're doing what they can and trying to limit their menus to get people in and out so that they can feed everyone who wants to eat. The grocery stores set up additional resupplies so that as their stuff is getting depleted, they can replenish it. One of the big concerns is if you own an electrical vehicle, my advice is don't bring it. We have one charging station up in Colebrook, and so if you're 99th in line to charge it, you're going to be there a while, which we don't mind. We'll enjoy it because it is during the mud season. This is normally the dead season, so we're really welcoming everybody. We're looking forward to everyone coming up there, boosting the economy. Our snowmobile season was kind of slow this year, so this will be a good boost. But with that being said, as the governor and others have said, it's going to take a lot of patience because there's going to be a lot of people. We have identified a number of parking spaces up there. There'll be signs up there directing where designated parking areas are. I think we've got 8 of them designated right now. Additionally, there is just north of Colebrook, there's a rest area, a welcome center. We've got permission from the state to close that off so that cars will not park there, so that we can direct all tourism buses and RVs that would take up a bunch of other parking spaces. We're going to have that open for RVs and buses to park there. It's a beautiful viewing area from there. You got a direct sight. I've gone out to all the parking areas, and they do have we're still able to see the sun from all those places at 5 at night, so they'll definitely be in the area. In an area where they can view it. Again, we're excited. We're welcoming everybody up there. We're looking forward to it. We're just asking you to be courteous of everybody that lives up there and to be safe. We want you to come up there and enjoy it, but also be safe. All the designated parking areas, we have put porta potties in there for the use of those that are staying there, as well as trash cans so that we can use the trash cans and keep the great Northwoods God's country and looking good for everybody. So we're looking forward to everyone coming up there, and I'll now turn it over to William Cass. He's the commissioner of the Department of Transportation.
Thank you, Jim. Good morning. It's glad to see everybody here. Everybody's very excited for the event and to have a lot of visitors. But with that amount of visitors that are expected, we could have widespread impacts to the traveling public. So we ask people to really please plan ahead as much as possible. Try to arrive early, stay late, stay put if you can to avoid backups and delays. And we ask everybody as they're coming up to find a safe place, maybe some of the parking spaces that Jim had mentioned. But you know, we want people to find a safe place away from traffic. We don't want people to be stopping on the road to try to watch the event. We certainly don't want people to be driving during the event. So arrive early, find a safe place to watch it. There's a lot of people that are going to be around interested in the event, so people in driving cars, we ask that you also be very cognizant and watch for pedestrians and bicyclists and others around. As far as being respectful too, we are looking to ask people to really stay on the major travel roads, town roads or minor roads that aren't really equipped for this traffic, both in structural condition and volumes, could lead to more problems. So we'll be looking to keep those for local traffic only and try to keep everybody on the main roads. But during the day, please keep an eye out. There'll be real-time traffic updates on newengland511.org to get updated traffic conditions and information through that. But I'll close by reiterating what a lot of people have already said. There will be delays. Expect delays. And we ask everybody to be patient. We want to have a enjoyable visit, and we want everybody to get home safely. So. Thank you. With that, I'll turn it back over to Governor Sununu.
Great. So again, we have some other individuals and members, representatives from Fish and Game and State Police. I mean, it really has been a coordinated effort. So happy to take any questions.
So we do have limited numbers. There's also an agreement with the state police where if there's needed for vehicles that are outside, you know, we need more than what we currently have and are using, we have the access ability to access others in other areas and have them there. I believe I even have heard that there may be some that are going to be staging further up north so they don't have such a travel time if something should happen. So. There are limited numbers, but there's also there's accommodations to have others in the area.
And I'd also make one note that on the main roads, I-95, I-93, the Effie Everett Turnpike, as people are leaving, we will have the DOT will be operating the service patrols to help any stranded or broke down vehicles clear those quickly and keep traffic moving on the major routes as well.
What else you got? No, hi. Oh, sorry.
Isn't one of the problems here as far as traffic, unlike the race at Loudoun, there's really no way to flood a lot of, expand how many cars you can bring into that area and how many cars you can quickly bring out, as they say. With Loudoun, you've got the travel plan and everything seems to work.
Sure.
Real quickly, but you don't have that up there when you close the
roads. Yeah, so again, to your point, the roads are you know, a lot of them are one lane each way, but there's not a single point too as well. So folks, we're hoping that folks and anticipate folks will be all across effectively COAS, which is gonna be able to see the bulk of the 100% eclipse. So it's not just a single point that folks will be venturing out to. There's various locations where you can see the full totality of the eclipse. So point well taken that the roads really aren't designed to handle this type of capacity, but at the same time, we're not just dealing with a single point of location. I think my guess is that the state park, you know, places like Coleman State Park, Colebrook itself, Berlin, Table Rock was mentioned, the Balsams area, those will all be kind of high traffic areas potentially, but they are all spread out over a pretty wide geographic area across COAS. Yes.
This is for
A lot. No, because there's no telling. One thing I've been telling people is that the path of totality, a lot of people, even though New Hampshire's in the path at 95%, path of totality is a lot more phenomenal than not being in the path of totality. I've had calls from Rhode Island. I've had calls from Eastern Mass. I've had radio or media stations from down in that area calling saying, what do you want our people to know? So I think Eastern New England is going to be, that's going to be their best chance of seeing it. I think South Eastern Maine, because they can hop on Route 26 and go across, I think that's going to be a route for them to be looking for to get into the path of totality. I have told the businesses up there that when I gave presentations is don't be surprised if it's tens of thousands. As was mentioned, there's already about 10,000 or so that are lodging there, so that's not counting your day commuters. So, and I've also told people if you're coming, you know, leave about midnight, get up here at 4 or 5, whenever, however many long it takes you to get there, park your car and, you know, take a couple hours nap and go eat some breakfast and do all that. But I think it's going to be a lot.
I would also add one other point. There are folks from across the country that want to see totality, right? And they have 13 different states to choose from. One of the issues is that it looks like the weather in the southern half of the United States is not going to be great that day. So those folks that are flying in, I got a call from someone from Texas yesterday saying that they were going to fly into Boston, and should they come to New Hampshire or Burlington, Vermont, or Maine to see it, which shocked me. I mean, folks are really, you know, flying their families in from a lot of different locations. So it doesn't mean they're all coming up to Cohasset and Colebrook, but again, we're anticipating well over 10,000 folks to inundate the area. And again, I hope this gives people confidence that if they give themselves time, we have the resources to manage.
Right, a great question. So the trail conditions are brutal. Deep snow on top of mud at the trailheads. At elevation, it's only magnified. It's not uncommon to have 6-7 foot drifts of snow at summit. So my best advice is if you want to enjoy the mountains, come back and book a second trip. This is not the weekend to do that.
Well, look through them. You should only be able to see something that's as bright as the sun. If you can see people, if you can see trees or furniture, they are not the glasses for you. Everything should just look black when you look through them, except for when you look at the sun. Or if you look at a super bright light bulb, you should only see the light bulb and not the lamp. So that's a good test. And no scratches. Make sure there's no scratches on the surface.
Okay. So the website again was?
NHSolarEclipse.com.
Right. NHSolarEclipse.com. I think that's a great website as well as the, oh, sorry.
And oh, I have a question.
You're answering the question.
I got another one. Yeah. It's going to be 59 degrees here.
Yes.
I don't know what it's going to be up north, but are we prepared for flooding?
Yes. The question is we're always prepared for flooding, but don't anticipate any significant floods in the area. We're already seeing some of the water levels go down, more significant flooding as aspects of the storm were observed on the seacoast, but don't anticipate any significant flooding up north. There'll be melting, as there's always a spring melt. It'll be muddy, but definitely nothing out of the ordinary. And I just want to reemphasize, I thought that was a terrific point that was brought up. Hiking is not ideal right now, much less than ideal. It could be outright dangerous and really not a time to be hiking in the backcountry where the snow depths and drifts right now are extremely dangerous. You could have avalanche issues in the Mount Washington, in the Presidential Range area. Folks are looking to be in that area. So we just, again, remind folks to take extreme precaution. This is kind of a few minutes of an event. Be somewhere safe, be at a point location, somewhere in Coas, but the backcountry hiking issue is probably not ideal for anybody this coming weekend, and would definitely hesitate to encourage anyone to come up for those types of activities.
Quick question on the website. Does it give the
So NH Solar Eclipse does the whole state of locations of for viewing, viewing parties, where to park, different events that are taking place. So it is beyond just Coos County, yes.
But given the weather, you're going to be able to see it pretty much everywhere in the state, which is pretty cool in one form or another. So, well, we thank everyone. Just want everyone to be safe, and let's go out and really enjoy Monday. It'll be a once-in-a-lifetime event. Thank you, guys.